Well, good morning. Good to see you guys this morning. Welcome to South Weymouth Nazarene Church. Those of you I can't see online who are seeing us, welcome to you as well. Sometimes when you read the scriptures, you think, what a great idea. And some people have done that in the past and said, I'm going to put that into a song. And our first song we have this morning has some of those ideas, whether or not maybe an exact quote of the Bible, but they're more, you might say, inspired by. And I love how these ideas that they've taken, some from the time, if you remember in your Bibles, where Jacob came, was isolated on his own, alone, left from his family, and he was wrestling at night with, he didn't know who, and ended up being the angel of the Lord, with God there. But he wrestled with these doubts, he wrestled with things before he could find his victory. And there are other times where, in the second verse it says, in the silence. And there are many times where we feel like we're crying out to God, perhaps, and we're not hearing anything. But we got to keep wrestling and keep going through those times so that in the end we see God, we see his face, we see the light of the world, the light that God has given to us. And in this passage, it talks about that light being a lighthouse, something we're very familiar with here in New England, where you see it and it guides you to the safety of the shore, out of the storms, out of the tempest, out of the waves and the wind, and to that place where you can rest, to that place of safety. And in our scripture verse we'll hear later, it talks about this idea of new heavens and new earths, and these ideas that God is going to bring us out of what has been into what he is creating for us. And so this morning, I'm kind of hoping that that's our what happens to us this morning as we come and worship, that God will take us wherever we've been and bring us here now into his place, into his house, into his love, in his loving arms. So I invite you to stand this morning. As we just come, let's seek the Lord.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa. You are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence you won't let go. In the questions your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa. You are the peace my troubles see. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, and I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. In my troubles my lighthouse, lying in the darkness, I'll follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, and I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. You will lead us through the storms, fire before for us. You're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Fiery for us. You're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Fiery for us. You're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. My lighthouse. My lighthouse. Shining in the darkness.
Hallelujah. Please be seated for our scripture reading.
Good morning. We'll be reading out of Isaiah 17 through 24. For behold, I create new heavens and new earth, and the former things shall not be remembered or come into mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in that which I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem to be a joy, and her people to be gladness. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and be glad in my people. No more shall be heard in the sound of weeping and the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who does not fill out his days. For the young man shall die 100 years old, and the sinner 100 years old shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be the offspring of the blessed of the Lord, and their descendants with them. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Let's stand as we sing the second verse.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me.
The one who set me free, hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. came. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh, hallelujah. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, your name is the victory.
Well, good morning. Happy Father's Day. We are so glad that you're here with us this morning. If you are new to South Weymouth, we would love to have you fill out one of these. It just helps us get to know you and follow up with you and get to know you a little better. Well, we have a lot of announcements today, so if you'd like to open up your worship folder with me, that would be great. Inside each of your worship folders, you're going to find one of these. Y'all want to find one and just wave it around just so I know that you've got eyes on it? Yes, thank you. So VBS is coming, and we are so, so excited. I think we're just about less than a month out, which is just kind of wild to me. We have had so much fun on Thursday nights getting decorations together. So for those of you that have been helping with that, thank you so very much. We are endlessly grateful for all the effort and work that you've been putting in. However, we cannot do VBS without each of you. So on this list, you will see a whole list of things that we need. This is just for snacks. If you are interested in donating, come find me after in the foyer, and I'm going to cross things out and write your names. And if we get doubles of things, that's fine, because we always need more snacks. And then we're going to find a different list next week. So it's just going to be a fun little surprise each week. Also, if you haven't signed up for VBS, please do so. If you have a neighbor who should sign up for VBS, tell them about it. If you have a cousin or a friend, we would love to have them at our Vacation Bible School this summer. Our primetimers have an exciting event coming up on Friday. Now, Pastor Dave, who qualifies for primetimers? Do I qualify? Excellent. No, really, who does qualify for primetimers? Anyone who can come. 40 plus. Oh, Pastor Jim is highly offended by that. So if if you see this and you identify with the Prime Timers, they want to see you on Friday. They're having a potluck lunch, I believe. There are signups on the Get Connected board right in the center. So we would love to know if you're going to be there with us. And we are excited for the Prime Timers event. This Saturday, yes, ma'am. I love questions. For this? Absolutely. Thank you for the question. I really appreciate that. This Saturday, we have an outreach event. And you might be wondering, well, what is an outreach event? We want to reach our neighbors here, but also your neighbors where you live. So we are going to be having an outdoor movie night right here at SWN. We're going to have it right in our beautiful outdoor space behind the building. Invite your neighbors. If you have a friend or a neighbor or a family member that has been thinking about, maybe they would be great to come to church and get to know Christ and be a part of a church body, this is a great event to bring them to. They can get to rub elbows a little bit with some of our people here and also watch a fun movie. So we would love to see them. Our movie starts at 8 p.m. Hopefully it'll be dark enough, but we're going to pray for clouds. There are many other announcements that you can look over. And at this time, I'd like to invite the ushers forward. Let's pray. Gracious God, we are just, again, so grateful to be here gathered in your name, God. God, we are reminded today that you are our living hope and that it is for you that we run after, God. God, would you bless your tithes and these offerings this morning? In your son's holy good name, amen.
Exactly how I feel, I can't begin to tell you what your love has meant. I'm lost for words. Is there a way to show the passion in my heart? Can I express how truly great I think you are? My dearest friend, Lord, this is my desire to pour my love on you like oil upon your feet, like wine for you to drink, like water from my heart. Pour my love on you. If praise is like perfume, I'll lavish mine on you till every drop is gone, and I'll pour my love on you. I don't know how to say exactly how I feel. I can't begin to tell you what your love has meant. I'm lost for words. Is there a way to show the passion in my heart? Can I express truly great I think you are, my dearest friend. Lord, this is my desire to pour my love on you like oil upon your feet, like wine for you to drink, like water from my heart. I pour my love on you. lavish mine on you, till every drop is gone, and I'll pour my love like oil upon your feet, like wine for you to drink, like water from my heart. I pour my love on you, your praise is like perfume. I'll lavish mine on you till every drop is gone, and I'll pour my love on you.
Let's pray. Father, we do want to express our love for you this morning. But as we seek to express our love for you, we are reminded that before we loved you, you loved us. You loved us so much that you sent your Son to die on the cross, that we might be forgiven of our sins. And there's no other way to respond to that than to love you in return. And we pray, Lord, that our love for you would be a surrendering of our hearts and lives to you this morning. As our Heavenly Father, we give you praise and we give you thanks for the provision that you make for us, for your love for us, for the sustaining grace that you shower upon us, for your mercy shown to us. We give you praise and we give you thanks. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege that we have of coming into your house this day, of singing praises to you, of lifting our voices in song, and giving praise to the work that you've done in our hearts and lives. And as we do, we realize, Lord, that there are many in our world today who cannot do what we are doing right now. And so we pray that you would extend your grace to them today. We pray for your protection upon those who are worshiping in secret or in hiding or in the midst of terrible destruction. We pray that your grace would be sufficient for them. As we think of this Father's Day, Lord, we do thank you for our fathers, but we realize that there are some who think of fathers in a more difficult way, and we pray that your grace would be extended to them today. We recognize that many earthly fathers do not follow the pattern that you have given to us, and we pray for those today who have suffered at the hands of fathers, and we pray that you would bring healing, that you would bring the power of forgiveness, that your grace would be sufficient for all of those. We pray, Lord, today for those who wish they could be fathers but are not. And we pray that you would heal that pain and that sorrow. We do give you praise today for the way that you help us in so many ways. We thank you for the joys that you bring into our lives. But we recognize, Lord, that there are also sorrows and difficulties that come our way. And we recognize, Lord, that sometimes we're not really even sure how we should pray in those situations. We come with questions of why, and there are no answers. but your Spirit has come and intercedes for us with groans that we cannot even utter. And so we cast ourselves upon you. You've told us when we are burdened and heavy laden to come to you and you'll give us rest. And so we come to you this morning, Lord, because your arms are open to us as we are. We do give you thanks and praise, Lord, for the work that you're doing in your church. We may not be able to see all that's happening, but we believe that your Spirit is working in our world, and we give you praise and thanks. We pray, Lord, for those who are proclaiming your message today, whether it be in their home countries or in countries that are far from home. We pray that you would bless your messengers today and that fruit would come from their labors. We pray, Lord, that there would be a moving of your Spirit in our own town, across our state, across our country. We pray that you would draw people to yourself and that people would find forgiveness and new life in Jesus today. We praise you for what you're doing and for what you're going to be doing in the days ahead as we put our trust in you. We give you thanks and we give you praise in the name of Jesus, who, when we pray, taught us to say, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen."
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Let's stand as we sing the second verse. Let's stand as we declare this to the Lord this morning.
Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Before you are seated, we're going to like to gather the children and send them right out the back with Miss Becky. And as we're doing that, let's just pray a blessing over our kids. Heavenly Father, we pray today that you would gather our little ones up in your arms of grace and protection. And we pray today that you would form and shape them after your likeness and your image, that they would stand among us as people who reflect the image, the simpleness, the character, the nature of God, and communicate by their very lives the gospel of grace, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Good to see you guys. Have fun. If you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn with me to Acts chapter 2. It's an interesting time in the life of the church. It's the third Sunday of Pentecost, and we're going to spend some time during the Pentecost season in the book of Acts, Acts of the Apostles, as we talked about 2 weeks ago. This third Sunday of Pentecost celebrates that really terrific season in which the work of the Holy Spirit is alive and well. That Holy Spirit that fills the disciples, that's us, fills us with the promise and the power of His presence, and then drives us out from this gathering place, from our meeting time together, into the world to bear witness. That's the word martyreo, right? That's the Greek word that the author of Book of Acts, Luke, uses to talk about witness. So when it means to witness, it's the same word that we get the word martyr from. The martyr is someone that we understand as someone who gives their life in service to the gospel. And so when the book of Acts talks about witnessing, what it's saying is we are empowered by the Holy Spirit to give our lives away in service to the gospel, or the good news, or the kingdom. The kingdom of Christ that rescues us, right, from a world of wreckage and sin, and then delivers us to, right, so to be saved is not just to be saved from something, but it's to be saved to something. So we're gathered out from the world of wreckage and sin and delivered unto a life of fulfillment, a life everlasting. And this morning, throughout the order of our service, we've come to this really peculiar place where the pastor takes a position behind a sacred desk. And the Bible is open to Acts chapter 2, and the notes are in hand, or at least on the iPad anyway. The people, you all, are expecting a sermon, right? Not a lecture, not a TED Talk, not a motivational speech, not advice about how to live your life in a way that helps you to cope and to be better, not instructions on quality of mental health or how to make the world even a better place, or how to be more kind or morally upright in the morally depraved world. Right now, in this place, in our order of service, the people have gathered and they're expecting a sermon. No doubt today, at least one sermon will be preached. I'll guarantee you that. And I have the interesting position that I get to preach a sermon on a sermon today. So by now you've found your place in the second chapter of the book of Acts. I'd invite you to, it's a fairly lengthy passage of scripture, so I'm going to invite you to be seated if you can in reverence of the reading of the Word of God and kind of follow along with us. We're picking up the reading in Acts chapter 2, verse 14. We'll read on through verse 39. The Spirit has recently been unleashed to the church on the day of Pentecost, and people have gathered from all different cultures and ethnicities in the city of Jerusalem, and they're hearing the wonders of the gospel preached in their own native language, and they're amazed and perplexed, and they're wondering to one another, what in the world is going on here? And so at this point, Peter raises his voice and addresses the crowd. But Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and proclaimed to them, "Men of Judah and all you residents of Jerusalem, let me explain all this to you. Pay attention to my words. For these people are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. On the contrary, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. And it will be in these last days, says the Lord, that I will pour out my spirit on all humanity. Then your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both young and old, male and female, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will display wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below. There will be blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the gathering of the remarkable day of the Lord. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." That's his text for the sermon. Peter continues, "Men of Israel, listen to these words. This Jesus, the Nazarene, was a man appointed to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs that God did among you through him, just as you yourselves know. Though he was delivered up according to God's determined plan and foreknowledge, you used lawless people and nailed him to a cross and executed him. But God raised him up, ending the pain of death, because it was no longer possible for him to be held by it. For David says of him, 'I saw the Lord ever before me. And because he is at my right hand, I'll not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, my tongue rejoices. Moreover, even my flesh lives in hope, because you will not leave me in the grave or let your Holy One see decay. You have revealed the paths of life to me and filled me with gladness in your presence.' Brothers, I can confidently speak to you about the patriarch David. He is both dead and buried, and his tomb is here today. And since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn an oath to him to sit one of his descendants on the throne. Seeing this in advance, he spoke concerning the resurrection of the Messiah. He will not leave in hell, and his flesh will not experience decay. God has raised this Jesus, and we all are witnesses," the word martyreo, "of this. Therefore, since he has been exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Spirit the promised Holy Spirit, and he has poured out what you both see and hear. For it was not of David's descendants that he was speaking, but of himself that the Lord declared, 'My Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet.' Therefore, let all the house of Israel know with certainty that God had made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. And when the people had heard this, they came under deep conviction, and they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, 'Brothers, what must we do?' 'Repent,' Peter told them. 'Be baptized, each and every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you also will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, it's for your children, and for all those who are near and far off, as many as who call on the name of the Lord. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.'" Let us pray. Almighty God, by the power of your voice that spoke creation to existence, who declare your good purposes throughout the prophets, and who calls the church into mission and gives her both the powerful voice and the powerful message, speak now by the activity of your Spirit among us. Let your word advance with great strength and power. Forgive and cleanse and heal and redeem. Form and shape and equip and empower us to boldly proclaim you to our world, both in deed and in word, we pray in the name of the Word made flesh. Amen. It's true. We sort of arrived at this place. It's a familiar place. We have seen and sung and celebrated, and the pastor has taken a place behind the sacred desk. The Bible's open, notes are in hand, the people are expecting sermon. Within the Church of the Nazarene, generally speaking, the Church of the Nazarene, generally speaking, and our local church in particular, the sacred desk, the pulpit, is a central focal point. By placing the pulpit in the middle of all the activity that goes on, in the spot probably most observable, we're making a statement. It's not here by accident. We put it here on purpose. By placing the pulpit in the center of the platform, we are communicating, for better or for worse, that some of the most important things that happen today happen from right here, from this place. Important things are done here. Now there are other important things that happen in our service, of course. There are other areas of emphasis that sit or stand or reside in close proximity to the center, right? The communion table, for example. And see here, the baptistry behind me, of course. And I'm glad the screen is up today. Thanks for putting that up. Because there are central areas of focus that we, on purpose, move people to draw their attention. The baptistry and the communion table, they draw our attention to the sacraments, right? The sacrament of Holy Communion and the sacrament of Holy Baptism. One of the great early church fathers, Augustine, said that the sacraments are visible words. Or, he said in another place, they're enacted sermons. Sermons preached not by an ordained elder that uses words, but sermon lived out by the people as they gather to bear witness, martyreo, to the gospel of God, the transforming power in our own lives for the entire world to see. All of these words spoken from a pulpit or demonstrated here among us in the sacraments, they all live or they all exist under the imposing shadow of the cross, another place of central emphasis for us. And you will note that the position of the pulpit is not the same in every church building that you've gone to. And I hope that you've been out to many various expressions of the Christian faith, and you've understand that there's not a cross in every sanctuary. And there's not a pulpit in every sanctuary. In fact, if you've gone to some places, you'll notice that the chancel or the pulpit and the reading places are pushed off to the sides, right? So you have a reader and then you have a preacher. What that does for us is that opens up the center point and it draws even more attention to the communion table or the altar or the cross or the crucifix. So that they're not obscured or obstructed by the preacher. That's done on purpose. And my comments today are not to place any kind of disparaging remarks on people who operate differently, but only to highlight for us what we do here in the Church of the Nazarene, what we do particularly here at the South Weymouth Church of the Nazarene. You see, for 135 years, or maybe even more, for over 135 years, about 135 years, the Church of the Nazarene has been a church that elevates and sort of emphasizes the importance of the preached word. That we've placed that to a place of emphasis in our services and in our sanctuaries. This moment where the pastor takes their place, opens the Bible with notes in hand, and the people gather to expect a sermon is an important moment in our lives. Something sacred and mysterious is about to happen here, and we anticipate it. In many ways, we gather together to hear today a word from the Lord. You've not come to hear me. I hope you haven't come to hear me, or whoever the guest preacher happens to be that day. As famous or infamous as those people might be, as interesting as they might be, and as easily and quickly as they could capture our attention, that's not why we've gathered. We've come today in anticipation to hear a word from the Lord. In the Church of the Nazarene, we work to identify and to set aside from among our own selves people who demonstrate the humble ability to communicate the word of the Lord, people who are sensitive to the voice of the Spirit and gifted in communication. We respond to the activity of the Spirit in the lives of people who demonstrate a particular kind of responsiveness or openness to the movement of the Spirit. And we take that gift, once we've identified it, and we sort of nurture it and we encourage it. and we help to develop it, and we make room in our services to exercise the gift of preaching. We legitimize that gift, and we foster that craft, and we encourage it by ordaining such people as elders in the church of God. When we talk about elders, we're not talking about people who are distinguished by age. What did you say, 40 years and up? So we're not talking about those kinds of people, right? To respect your elders sort of thing. I think you should do that, but that's not what we're talking about here. When we talk about elders, we identify them by maturity, which is not sort of encapsulated by a particular age group. An elder is someone who we officially recognize by the gift and graces of God as someone who is equipped and trained for pastoral ministry, but particularly for the ministry of preaching, like Peter in the second chapter of the book of Acts. And we hold in high regard the office of the ordained elder, and we expect that those women and those men called into this ministry will spend their lives nurturing and exercising and improving their craft out of a deep love for Christ and out of a passion for God's people. I'd like to recognize three of those elders today, and we're going to invite to the platform Reverend Betty Jean Goodwin, Dr. Reverend David Restrick, and Reverend Kayla Kish this morning. The platform's not a big surprise to them. If you guys could come up and stand behind me, right up here. So we face the congregation. Everyone wants to see you. And I will talk about you a little bit, if you don't mind. Reverend Betty Jean Goodwin is with us. Two of these have changed their ordination status at the District Assembly on the 9th and 10th of this month. Right, we've moved these two lovely people from the status of ordained elder in the Church of the Nazarene to retired elder in the Church of the Nazarene. Hang on, everybody, because when we first announced this, everyone from our church who was at assembly kind of looked back at me and said, "What do you mean they're retiring?" Well, it's a change in status. It's not really a change of vocation for them. But that retirement is not a biblical category, right? It doesn't mean that we sit back in our rockers and just kind of relax and chill out for the rest of until Jesus comes. These guys are readily employed. But it does help them with the ability to say this simple word, no. Right? So they're no longer obligated to take on ministry roles. They can take on ministry roles as they need to. And so in this massive pool of churches that need good pastors, these are retired elders. We've just kind of taken them out of the option for them. We can intern for a little while, and they can help support, but they're not going to lead a church into the next generation. But they're retired elders, and we distinguish and honor them. As Pastor Dave, what do you say about tires?
You get new tires and go in another direction.
Retirement means you get new tires and you move in another direction. I want to talk about Betty Jean Goodwin because she's probably the least familiar to us here. Betty Jean Goodwin was ordained in the Church of God in 2001. And she has faithfully pastored the Vermontville Church of the Nazarene in upstate New York for 4 years. She taught at the Adult Studies Program at Eastern Nazarene College for an additional 4 years, and she has most recently pastored our Worcester First Church of the Nazarene for 12 consecutive years. We're proud and thankful for her ministry. She continues to serve as chaplain for Marketplace Ministries, and she's engaged in all kinds of sort of counseling opportunities that are for her. And Betty Jean, we are so very blessed that you have decided to call South Weymouth Church of the Nazarene home. We are thankful for your many years of faithful service, and we're excited to have you as part. And you bless us with your ministry and your presence here. Pastor David, thank you. Can you see Reverend Dr. David Restrick behind me? Is he sort of hiding back there? Maybe I could do this. Dr. Restrick serves as a pastor in the UK at Weston Supermar since he started in 1982 there, if I have my information correctly. He was ordained as an elder in the Church of God in 1985. He's appointed as a missionary by the Church of the Nazarene, serving as academic dean at our Bible College in South Africa from 85 to 89, and after language study in Portugal, they're teaching the Bible College in Swaziland, which is now Eswatini, right? Saying that right? Until appointed as academic dean of the seminary in Maputo, Mozambique from 92 to 2013. He taught 3 years at Eastern Nazarene College and he has been a beloved member of the pastoral staff here for about a decade, and we are so appreciative of your ministry, and we are the direct benefits of your tender pastoral care, your terrific heart that reflects to us Jesus, and the way that you teach us simple things like to pray and to love and to serve. And we want you to, when you leave here, we're gonna make the opportunity available. We want you to grab two of these rocking chairs, one for you and one for your spouse, and take them home with you. And remember us as you sit, you are supported by the church. And as you have the freedom to say yes and no to ministry, you are certainly encouraged, and we come alongside of you, and we want to bless you at least with an opportunity for you to remember us a little bit as you're relaxing in these years and looking forward to the next dinner. But we want you to stay up here real quick, because at District Assembly, we not only have the ability to retire two ordained elders, but we brought Pastor Kaler on to take their place. So you have big shoes to fill. Like, we're moving a generation of two out, and only one of you is coming in, but she is exceptional. And if you know her, you absolutely, absolutely know that. Pastor Kaler, I have something for you. Your resume is not quite as big as theirs just yet. So we want you to know that we submit to your authority. We recognize your gift. And we want to encourage you as part of the body of Christ to preach the word and be faithful with the handling of the gospel. And so we're going to ask you to open that real quick, because the young folks, they have a symbol, right, that we're giving them for their retirement and the change. But do it. Open it right up. So if you know me, you know I didn't wrap that. I haven't put that kind of, you can thank her later. This is a symbol that we want to give you so that when you hold it, and when you work with it, and when you read it, you remember that you don't do it alone, that you do it with us and among us, and even if you're not in our sanctuary, we're with you. I'm really excited about that. It's genuine leather. It's got your name on it. Yeah, open it right up. No one's going to misplace it, and it's for you to take to you and with you. Let's take a moment and honor our ordinands. You may take your seats. Sorry if I caused you any embarrassment. You don't have to take these with you. We'll make sure that they get to your houses. Oh, Jesus, Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, look mercifully upon all who humbly come before you in service of the gospel, whether ordained or not ordained. We lay down our crowns today and our pride and our degrees and accomplishments and status for the basin and the towel. And we are thankful for the privilege of suffering with you, so that some hurting, broken, lost soul might find rest and healing and wholeness in you. Enable us by the continual infilling of your Holy Spirit to preach good news, to live out sermons, and faithfully shepherd your people. Amen. You know, as far back as Acts chapter 2, we give witness to the gospel in the form of sermon. And at last, we've kind of arrived at that place where the pastor or the preacher for the day takes a place behind the sacred desk, the Bible open, notes in hand. We have come to expect a sermon. One of the ways that we bear witness to the Word of God is our response to the activity of the Holy Spirit. How are we responding to what God is doing among us? In Acts chapter 2, the Apostle Peter gives witness to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in his first sermon ever preached to the masses of people who are gathered there at Jerusalem. They're starting to hear the good news that God has come to them in Christ. And the purpose of that endeavor is to reconcile a lost and hurting world, to gather that world into himself, to redeem it, to heal it, and to deliver it. The people are trying to make sense of what's happening because they're hearing that good news in their own languages, and much of what's happening is really quite bizarre, and they're wondering if this is a miracle or if it's bad food or what in the world is happening to us, if perhaps maybe the followers of Jesus have had too much to drink this morning. They're hearing a sermon, not a TED talk, not a lecture, not a motivational speech. But what is it really about a sermon that sets it apart and distinguishes it from the rest of public speaking? What is it about the sermon that makes it a sermon and distinguishes it from a political speech, for example, or a State of the Union, or something of that nature? A word from the Lord addressed to the people of God concerning our relationship with God, our relationship with one another, the world that God created. That's what distinguishes it from the rest. A word from the Lord that addresses the people of God about our relationship with Him, with one another, and the world around us. And perhaps maybe the most distinguishing characteristic of a sermon is, of course, its content. The subject matter of the sermon is God. Preaching concerns itself with the activity of the Holy Spirit in our world. And the purpose of the sermon is to identify what is God up to in the world? What's He doing? And how can the church be a part of what He's doing? What God is doing here is He's ordaining a next generation of preachers to take their place, for Kayla to take her place in shaping and forming the church into the future. What God is doing here is honoring the lifetime commitment of those who have martyreo, poured out their lives as witness to the good news of the gospel, that all of God was in Christ, reconciling and redeeming a lost and broken world, gathering it to Himself. And so Peter talks about, hey, this is what God is doing. Guys, these men are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. This is the activity of God foretold to you by the prophet Joel. You should already know about this. In the last days, God said, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women in those days, I will pour out my spirit and they will prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below. You'll see blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's a promise. That's a promise that you can build life around. And Christian preaching highlights this gospel. It announces the good news. The good news, everyone. This is the good news. You ready? God is up to something creatively, mysteriously, unexpectedly amazing in our world. And you and I, we're invited to be a part of it. That's the good news. God is up to something in our world. And we have been invited to be a part of it. Hey, good news, everyone. God, everyone who calls on His name, God promises, shall be saved. Good news, everyone. There is help today. There is strength today. There is deliverance and power. There's a blessedness in the midst of our struggle and the grind. There is rest for your weary soul, and there is healing for your wounded person. Good news today. You and I, we're not left all by ourselves to kind of figure out the world as we go along, as if God created the world and then sent us spinning and say, good luck, everybody. Try to figure that out. If you need me, I'll be here. That's not how it works. God has not left us alone to figure it all out by ourselves. We are not without help. We are not without guidance. We are not without purpose or value, and we are not left without love. Good news, everyone. Our God comes to us, and He rescues us. He delivers and heals and strengthens, and He comforts us in our darkest hours, and He makes our life whole. Christian preaching announces this good news, that all of God, in the person of Jesus, reconciles a lost and broken world to Himself. He's not allowing sin or wickedness to undo or take it over. Good news, everyone. He comes to us. Now, the bad news, I mean, there's good news and there's bad news. The bad news is, well, with the help of wicked men, we rejected God's advances to us. We have failed to welcome His help. We've disgraced Him, quite frankly, and we've killed Him by nailing Him to the cross. The bad news is, what did God get in exchange for His efforts to rescue us? He got an execution. That's the bad news. But we don't end on bad news, because it's not the end of the story. There's good news still. The good news here that Peter talks about in his sermon is that even in death, God is active in the world. Even in death. Some would say, especially in death, we can trace the activity of God in the world. Peter identifies this activity and he announces good news by saying, but God raised him from the dead, saving him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep his hold on him. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses. What? Martorell. We all give our lives to testify, right? Give our lives to this good news. Our existence now is shaped as witnesses. Because he is raised from the dead, we are witnesses. We give our lives in service to this good news. That all of God was in Christ, reconciling a lost and broken world to himself, but we exchanged that goodness by, well, nailing him to the cross. But the good news is that God raised him from the dead, and we now are witnesses of that. That's who we are as a people. God exalted him to the right hand of the Father, and he has received from the Father the Holy Spirit that has now been poured out on us. We are witnesses. This is what you see. This is what you hear. This is the good news. The good news that not even death itself can prevent God from rescuing people. Not doesn't prevent God from rescuing me or you or that person or those people out there or who you've been praying for and who you're going to visit today. Not even in death or darkness or chaos can prevent the rescue of God. Not an army, not a government, or not an empire can stop the rescue of God. Not the lack of our abilities or lack of resources or lack of opportunities will stop God from rescuing people. Not my mistakes, not my colossal stupidity of my choices, not the severity of my own rebellion, not the weight of my shame or the hiddenness of my embarrassment or the depth of my own unworthiness will stop the rescue of God, because anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, will be delivered, will be healed. The good news is that God raised him from the dead, saving him from the agony of death, because it's impossible for death to keep its hold on him. And God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of this experience. He exalted him to the right hand of the Father and has received from him the promised Holy Spirit, which he is now pouring out upon us. It's this Holy Spirit that burns in the heart of the church like a fire. It gives us life and energy and creativity and boldness and persistence. And it sends us, it drives us out from places like this to the people so that we might continue to bear witness, to give our lives away in service of the good news in every generation and in every world area, from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So from Weymouth to the South Shore to the New England to across our nation and to the ends of the earth. It's this Holy Spirit that emboldens the church to not only preach good news, but to embody it, to live it out in our lives and in our world. God has a word for his people today. It's a word of comfort for those who are struggling and asking the why question. Why me? Why them? Why now? Why here? It's a word that God has of instruction for those who need a life lesson on how to live out Christian faith in an anti-Christian world. For some, it's a word of discipline and correction. It's a word of redirection or repentance, for example. It's a word of guidance and direction for those who are seeking their next step. What happens to me after my credentials have moved from elder to retire? Or what happens to me as I'm looking for a new... Or what happens to me in this moment of transition of life? God has a word for his people. The Holy Spirit changes and challenges and redirects, and it burns within the heart of the Jesus people so that we witness to the relentless search of rescue of God's own efforts in our world. Yeah? The Holy Spirit fills the people and drives us from places like this to the ends of the earth so that anyone who calls on the name of the Lord can be saved. The only proper response to the infilling of the Holy Spirit, according to the book of Acts, is martyrel. The only proper response to the infilling of the Holy Spirit is to give your life away in service of the gospel. The only proper response to the abiding presence of Christ in our life is to bear witness to that life in the world. So Peter's sermon offers a word of God for the people of God. And the people, they bear out that witness in the world. What are we supposed to do now? Well, be baptized. Repent, right? Turn around. Be baptized, every one of you. Because the promise is for you, but not just for you. It's also for your children. Appropriate word on Father's Day, I think. But not just for the, but also for people who are near and people who are far off. That's the promise. It's for everybody. So that everybody who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And when I think about what it means to call on the name of the Lord and be saved, Peter's preaching this sermon, and I love this passage of scripture, or the story, right? So this is, Jesus feeds all kinds of people, right? Feeding of the 5,000, the 4,000, I don't remember which one it was. Thousands of people, let's just say. And the people there, they're like, wow, I mean, this guy can make food come out of nowhere. Let's make him king. And so he says, yeah, king's not my thing right now. And so Jesus withdraws to a place, but he sends the disciples across the lake. The disciples are really familiar with the lake, right? They know boats. They know fishing. They're out in the lake. It's late at night, and then suddenly chaos ensues, right? The boat is being swamped. Everything is unpredictable, and every last thing that the disciples know how to do is just coming unraveled. So they're at the mercy of the sea in its chaos. And here comes Jesus, middle of the night, strolling across the water, about to pass by, and they call out to him, hey, is that you? And he's like, yeah, it's me. And then Peter has to make a decision. Do I stay in here in the boat with these guys? Doing nothing, like trying to survive, about to be tipped over. But this is everything that I know. And this is everything that I love. And this is me. This is what I'm comfortable with. Or do I step out into the storm and walk with Jesus in everything that I don't know and nothing that I've ever experienced before? Peter says, hey, if it's you, then call me out. He's asking for a sign, right? If it's you, then call me out there. And so Jesus says, it's me. Come on out. And so Peter gets out of the boat. Honestly, I don't know if that's me. I like to think that I would be like, yeah, easy. I'd rather be out in the middle of the chaotic sea with Jesus than in the boat sinking with these guys. But I hope that would be me, but I don't know. But Peter, he slides out of the boat, takes a couple steps. What happens to him? Figures out where he is and what's going on. He suddenly comes into his own right mind and starts to sink a little bit. And his prayer, that desperate prayer. Now this is me. This is me every day, twice on Sundays. His prayer is this. Lord, save me. That's it. That's it. That's the desperate cry. And what does Jesus do? Saves him. Why? Because everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. When I think of Peter preaching this sermon from the book of Joel, I mean, I think of that experience for him. Like, this is what it's like. And Jesus, he steps into the boat, the seas come down, and he says, oh, you of little faith. Little faith? He just stepped out into the big chaotic sea. He thought to himself, I'd rather be out there in the unknown where the storm is thrashing than in here in the boat with these guys. Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? Good news today. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And that prayer is not complicated. It's simple. It's easy. Lord, save me. It's three words. God comes to his people and nothing can stop his search and rescue. Have you been searched for today? Are you being searched for? Have you been found? Have you been rescued? Have you asked God to forgive and restore, to wash you, to reclaim you, to reconcile you to himself? From a life of death and misery to a life of holy purpose, of joy and love. Have you found a home in the family of God, among the people of God, life everlasting? Have you been delivered and saved and healed? Are you being delivered and saved and healed? Then, if the answer to that question is yes, then you're one of us. Martireo. The task now is to give your life away in service to the gospel. It's the only proper response to the deliverance of God. It's what Peter does. He's been saved, and now he gives his life away in response. What happened to us when we were saved, it can happen to anybody. We can all be witnesses because everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And the Apostle Paul asks the questions. He says, you know, how can we call on the one that we've not believed in? How can we reach out to one that we don't trust? And then he says, how can they believe in the one whom they've never heard of? And how can they hear unless somebody preaches to them? And they answer the question simple. They can't. They're unable. It's not possible. And that's why we exist. And that's our reason and our purpose for being, to communicate the wonders of God in languages and in ways that people understand so that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord can be saved. Who are you witnessing to? Who are you discipling? What are their names? Do you have their cell phone numbers? Who are those people that you are calling into the family? Who are those people that you're reaching out to? Who are those people that you're giving your life away? Sharing good news. Who are the people to whom God is sending you? Are they drowning in the cold darkness of this world? Are they people in need of rescue? Are they reaching their hands out? Are there people in our lives that God is searching for? Maybe today, that person is you. And maybe today you feel like you're drowning or suffocating, or maybe all your options are slipping through your fingers, and every time you try to do something, it ends badly, and you're reaching out to grab hold and lay anything, or maybe you're searching for hope, or you're desperate for a change, and if your life is spinning out of control, or you're hurting yourself, or maybe other people, or if you're desperate in need of help, you might be at the right place at the right time, because He's searching for you. You can call on the name of the Lord, and He will save you. You have a place in the family of God, an important position here in the kingdom. I know that this is true because it happened to me, and I am a witness, and I'll be willing to bet that there are other people in our sanctuary that it happened to them too, and they are now therefore witnesses. I know it can happen to you because it happened to me, and it happened to us. I'm a witness. And if maybe today all you can say is, I'm lost, Lord, find me. Or I'm sinking, Lord, save me. Or if I'm trapped and in prison and I'm confused and I'm all tangled up, Lord, set me free. That's where you start. And that's your prayer. And it's really as simple as that. You keep coming here. You keep saying those prayers. You keep opening up your heart and your life. You keep coming here and standing on that promise, and then He will deliver and He will come through, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on Him. Not even death can prevent Him from His search and rescue. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. We're going to sing that song, Mighty to Save, again. I want you to know that these altars are open, and they are central, and they're here for a reason and for a purpose, and you can take advantage of them. But you don't have to. This is a good place for you to come and to gather. And I think on a day like today, you have people that you've been praying for. You have people to whom you have been sent. You have people whose faces and names are coming before your mind right now that you are responsible for, to be a witness. And maybe you want to come and offer yourself in service to the gospel. Maybe you want to respond to a call to preach. Or to minister. Or maybe you just want to yield yourself for whatever the Holy Spirit is doing. This is the time. This is the place. This is how we respond to the gospel. Martirel. Today, I'm going to invite you to stand, if you will. And let us sing this song together. This gives you an opportunity to slip out and to move. And maybe your response for is to kind of sit quietly and let this song wash over you. From a position of standing to a position of seating. Maybe you want to stay. And raise your hand and say, this is my song, this is my testimony. Maybe you want to come forward. However the Lord is leading you to respond, we're going to give you this song to respond. Mighty to Save.
Everyone needs compassion.
love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. The hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. And fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Now may God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be found and gathered in Him, reconciled, and be filled with the Holy Spirit, that we might be driven out from this place into our own areas of influence and mission to bear witness and give our lives away for the gospel, in deep love of its King and passion for the people that He's created. God bless you. Happy Father's Day. You are dismissed.